Welcome to another episode of Behind the Dreamers. I'm your host, Jennifer Loading, and we are talking to the achievers, the creators, the magic makers, and the dreamers. These are our friends, these are your friends, and they are living the extraordinary. Well, today I'm thrilled to have two incredibly talented individuals on the show. One is a seasoned hip-hop artist, rap artist with over a decade of musical expertise. The other is a versatile graphic designer, illustrator, comic book artist, and writer. Together, they've created a captivating young adult graphic novel about making the earth a better place for all living beings. So I'm super excited to chat with them today. But before I get them on, we do need to do a quick announcement for our sponsors. Shout out. This episode is brought to you by Walt Mills Productions. Need to add excitement to your YouTube videos or some expert hands for editing? Look no further. Walt Mills is the solution you've been searching for. Walt is not only your go-to guy for spicing up content, he's the force behind a thriving film production company with numerous titles in the pipeline. Always on the lookout for raw talent, Walt is eager to collaborate on film and internet productions. With a background deeply rooted in entertainment and promotion, Walt Mills leverages years of skills to give you the spotlight you deserve. Want to learn more about Walt and his work? Head on over to waltmillsproductions.net and let your content shine.
Entrepreneurs, are you ready to level up your leadership skills? Tune in now for an exclusive offer designed just for you.
This is my time!
Did you know 63% of consumers prefer businesses aligned with their values? Recognizing your core values isn't just vital for business growth, it's the bedrock of effective leadership. Whether you're a seasoned entrepreneur or an aspiring creator, identifying your core values is a key step in constructing the framework of a successful leader, enabling you to lead authentically, expand your business, and live life on your terms. Are you ready to access tools to kickstart your leadership journey? Unlock a treasure trove of insights and get your free resources at www.linktree.com/Jennifer Loading. Take that crucial first step toward realizing your leadership aspirations and elevate your leadership game today. Ready to shine.
All right, so now we got all that out. I get to welcome my guest on the show. I'm so excited. I always have to put the little plugs in because we want to help people be the most effective leaders that they can be. And so my guests today, Tim Blessed and Michael LaRiccia, are the dynamic duo behind the book, Planeta, I like this, Blue, Volume 1, Rise of Agoo. Tim Blessed, the author, and Michael is also the illustrator. Through their collaboration, they introduce us to a world of courage, compassion, love, and sacrifice. And so welcome, guys. I'm so excited to have you on the show today.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having us.
Glad to be here.
And thank you for being patient as I got all that out.
No worries. That's the name of the game, right? Patience.
That's right. Well, I am so excited. So I want to talk about a little bit about this book, what led to the inspiration, because you guys bring different skill sets to the creation of this. And so tell us a little bit about the inspiration behind this.
Yeah, so I've been a storyteller for a while through music, hip hop music, and socially conscious. So most of it very positive, conscious music. And, you know, I have kids. Now I have four. And at the time, three of my sons, I was telling them bedtime stories like I do with my daughter now. And, you know, they were often silly, often, you know, about talking chickens or whatever it was. But at some point, I started telling this story of Planeta Blue about these young people who, you know, get whisked away underwater to Atlantis and get put on trial for what's the human beings are doing to the planet and to animals and to each other. And so that story wasn't just staying in my mind at that moment. It kind of went on to waking hours. And I found myself thinking about that story more and more and decided to just write it, just start writing it and to talk about these young people that I knew a lot about and know a lot about as a youth worker. So not only am I a hip hop artist, I work many years in nonprofits and was like, let me show these young people as the brilliant young people that they are in this fantastic sci-fi adventure that has a lot of action and talking animals. But it's, you know, these animals aren't wearing clothes, so not Disney type. And they're dealing with some real issues like climate change and pollution and just you know, what happens in zoos and to seals, right? So it's like heavy stuff, but in a way that young people can access it. It's for young adults, but I say, you know, anyone from 7 to 70, I think will enjoy this, and maybe even beyond, because I'm somewhere in the middle there, and I enjoy graphic novels and comics like the young people. And so, you know, so I started writing it. Took me 5 years because I was always doing music along with it. That's really my passion. But, you know, at some point I had to just put that aside and focus on it. So I wrote the whole story out, and then was like, you know, I had a publisher in New York who wanted to put it out as long form, but I knew I wanted it to be a visual expression of it, mainly because for me, who immigrated from West Africa, reading was a challenge at first. And so comic books was my entry point. And so having the visuals there really helped me engage with literature. And so when I recorded, when I wrote it, I was like, I need to get me an artist, find me an artist. I looked around, and luckily I found this guy who was amazing, Mr. Mike LaRiccia, amazing artist. And he really had the vision and the ability and the skills to bring these words to life.
That's so awesome. Well, and I think the thing that, you know, you said so many great things there, but I think like the resonating thing with me and all of this is the storytelling, right? Because it's interesting. I just built out this totally different. I've written a book before, but nothing like what you're doing. Completely different, because I'm in the coaching space. And so I just built this really big program out. And the entire program, I tell people, it's kind of like this immersion experience. It's not where I tell you these points. It's where I show you these points. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to get my message across why you need to know, like, about these core values, which you heard me talk about in the beginning. But how do you tell somebody what that is without really giving them an example of what that is, right? And so I think storytelling is so powerful, to your point, you know, and having come from the space that I did, I was in Mary Kay for many, many years, like 22 years, some. And we always talked about nobody ever cares what, you know, really cares what you sell till they know why you do what you do, right? So I came from a space where storytelling was really what we did. And so I think it's great when you can find a place, and whether it be your music, you know, that you've done it for years in that form. I do it in my podcasting, you know, how we can tell our story to other people and get things out there and show it and create those messages that we want to send out for the right audience that we're trying to hit. So congratulations to you both on that front. And I totally get it. I mean, I get the whole storytelling thing.
Yeah. No, thank you. And you know, we always tell the story of how we met and what, you know,
share that with us, because I'm curious, because you're in the same room right now. For our people that are listening, you're in the same room right now. So you got to tell us about this.
Yeah, we are. Well, it's awesome because we both Mike and I went to UMass Amherst for undergrad, and we ended up back in the same area.
At different times.
Yeah, I'm Mike Senior, so
he's a little older than me.
Respect your elder, Mike.
Just want to make that very clear. No, it was not at the same time.
Yeah, it was not at the same time. We did not know each other at all. In fact, when I graduated was when you were coming in.
I was just starting.
You were just starting. He was a young youngster when I graduated. So I had a friend also from UMass who you know, knew I had written this story, and she was like, "Hey, I know you're looking for an artist. I know this amazing artist who's my neighbor." And I was like, "Yeah, okay, you know, an artist who's a neighbor." I was like, "You know, do you got something? Like, show me something of his." And she sent me his web address, and you know, I was just blown away because his art is just so phenomenal. And I was like, "I think he, you know, this is the guy. This could potentially be the guy." And you know, so she put me in touch with him, and when, you know, we met up, it was like instantly, you know, chemistry instantly. When we talk about core values and principles, you know, Mike has, and we share a lot of the same principles, which is really about, you know, family, about, you know, being honest, being authentic, being who you are, and ultimately for the betterment of humanity, to be honest, just to hit it the nail right on the head. But also, you know, for the culture of comics and storytelling, all the things that were important to me, I found in Mike. But, you know, I'll let him tell his side of it, because, you know, I don't know. I think he was trying to get away. I don't know when he saw that. He's just joking.
I, you know, it's funny when we talk about this, it's when he says it was my neighbor, I only had one house next to me at that time. On the other side, it was the street. So the only neighbor I had happened to be this mutual connection. And, you know, it was a similar situation where the neighbor's like, I have a friend who wrote a book. And in my mind, I'm like, I know lots of people who've written books, you know, like that could mean anything. Yeah. And a lot of times as an artist, you find people who have a project and they're new at it and they want you to be involved. And it's usually something like, well, you know, I can't pay you, but if right. we sell the book, you get a percentage, and it's sort of this sort of gamble. So I, going into it, I was sort of like, I really don't want to get involved in that kind of situation, you know. But when we met and he showed me the project, it was sort of like I could feel like the energy behind this work, you know. And I could see that this was something that he was invested in, that it was something he was going to continue to put energy into. And the work itself stood on its own. Like, I, you know, he gave me the book. I read it and I was like, you know, this is something I commit to for a, I mean, it's not a short book. It's, you know, he gave me about 100 pages of text. So translating that to a comic book is going to be, it ended up being double that. So taking on a project that big, it's going to be something that is worthwhile in a lot of ways. And especially since, you know, you're going to be devoting all this time to it. So our initial meeting, I was on board. I said, I'll do a few pages and do some concept work. Let's see what that looks like. And then when we found that the working relationship was good, because this is sort of a time for us to test each other out.
Right.
To see, hey, you know, like, do we work well together? Is this going to be difficult? It turned out to be good. And we decided we're going to do a Kickstarter. And then, you know, we've ended up here. That's the depression over all the details, but it's worked out very well.
I was getting kind of, I was chuckling. I love the story, by the way. I was chuckling a little bit because I do so much networking here. And I know when y'all were saying, I had this friend, because I, you know, right? When you're in that space, like everybody's got a friend that does something. And I laugh because, you know, being in the podcast world, you guys probably seen this yourself. Every day somebody's like telling me, I know somebody that can help you with this. And somebody's mm-hmm. pitching me this. And, you know, it's always like, oh yeah, I know like 20 people that do that, you know, yeah. But then you meet that one. I think there are those moments, you know, like I meet so many people and I'm sure you guys do. And this clearly was a situation where it worked out, like, right. Like there you had this connector in the middle that brought you two together. Right. And it worked out. There are those moments, you know, and I feel like, yeah, you put yourself the opportunity in the right, you know, put yourself to make the opportunity available and the right people show up when they're supposed to show up, because there'll be those moments, you know, where I look back even through the course of my work and I'll be like, you know, this person showed up and had I not been doing this, had I not been open to the opportunity, they would have never crossed my path and we wouldn't be here today doing what we're doing, you know? So it worked out. And I'm glad for that for you guys, because I think that's awesome. You guys were able to make that work and get this thing pulled together. But it is, we've all kind of been in that place of, is this the thing that we're supposed to be doing? And is this a person we're supposed to be working with? And, but you yes. know, I think you just know.
Yeah. And it takes some faith, right? You have mm-hmm. to, when you embark on something, you know, this big, as far as writing a book, like, as we know, you know, a lot of people had this dream of writing a book. I didn't know I had this dream because music was my dream for so long. But eventually it was like, yeah, this is a dream, but how am I going to get there? Right. How are you going to get to this, the finish line? Because it is a marathon, right? It's not a sprint at all. But you know, I think it's always important. I love to share, like, you have to just commit to it. You know, at some point you just have to say, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to finish it no matter what it takes. It might take long, right? I'm going to set a goal. I'm going to set a time frame. However, the important thing is that it actually gets accomplished. And I think a lot of people might sell themselves short just kind of debating, right? I know a lot of artists who make amazing music or amazing art, but they just kind of hold it to themselves because they're a little timid in putting it out in the world or don't know the right way. And I like to say there's no wrong way. You know, as we know now, through, you know, putting ourselves out, I'm an entrepreneur, right? And as an author and a musician, that all of these steps, even what we consider failures aren't, you know, it's just a learning process. And to cultivate that strength, to say, you know, to be resilient and to say that, hey, I'm just going to stick this through. It always pays off. At least that's what I found out. You know, at the end of the day, I've learned from it. I've learned what it is. And now having gone through the music thing, at first I was, you know, just so hungry and just couldn't wait. Like, you know, we talked about patience, being patient. I just wanted to be on stage. Like, give me the mic. I want to rap. With the book, you know, you realize like, hey, a lot of it is the journey, and it's become cliche, right? It's not a destination. It's a journey, but it's true. You know, the wisdom behind it is it's true that it is a journey. And so I've been enjoying the journey, even the mundane things is, you know, writing emails or promoting, right? Like, I don't, yeah, I have been enjoying it. Like,
Michael's like, I don't know about that. Hey, yeah, I'm with you. I just got through talking to a guy in marketing and I was talking about my podcast and I'm like, he says, yeah, you like need to put out like, you know, like 8 pieces of content per thing. And I'm like, 8 pieces of content. Like, I'm lucky if I get one put together. Oh my gosh. Like, right. You got to know your strengths. Yeah. You got to know when to delegate. And you got to be patient with the process. You know, but I think this is all good messaging. Yeah. I would really love to know, and even Michael, you chime in on this. Tell me, because you said a lot of really good things here, some of the other challenges that you guys went through. I mean, because obviously you're coming from you know, still create a space for you, Tim, right? Still create a space, but a different creative form. Michael, you talked a little bit about taking on this project. You weren't sure. So maybe just some other of the challenges, maybe on just maybe doing the book itself, like that you guys went through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I can jump in. I want to go back to the idea of when the challenge of taking on a large project is always, you know, something that is very specific to each situation. Because, you know, when we did the book, it was actually right during the pandemic. So we actually met before the quarantine. And then during that whole period, you know, ended up doing this project while my children were home. So I have 2 young children. And, you know, like I didn't prepare for that. No one was prepared.
That's
for that.
A whole nother thing too.
Yeah. So, you know, that in itself. So I bring that up only because there's unforeseeable challenges that come up with any project. And I feel like if the smart move is to sort of bake in some wiggle room so that you're prepared if something like comes your way and you have to be able to, you know, whatever. So I think in the sense that Tim and I were on such a good wavelength in terms of our workflow and the sort of our shorthand, gave me a lot of flexibility in how I was working and, you know, my pace and everything like that. So, you know, the challenge of just getting the thing done was essentially the biggest. And then it was basically navigating these worlds that we weren't too familiar with, which were like printing and shipping and, doing crowdfunding campaigns and things like that. So sort of learning on the job, you know, as quickly as we can. And then in learning and making mistakes at the same time. So, so I think like that just comes with any large undertaking. And I feel like the both of us have sort of had enough life experiences that we're okay with that and have that expectation that, okay, there's going to be things that we're going to have to deal with. Let's just keep the momentum going, problem solve, and, you know, complete the task, you know, so.
Yeah, I think for me, one of the biggest challenges was, you know, when we successfully completed the Kickstarter, there was a date which we set to deliver the book. And it was really important. You know, I'm very goal driven, as Mike is. And so for us to have these backers, these folks who, you know, had pledged, you know, pre-ordered, if you will, but pledged them out and said like, yeah, we believe in this project. And you said you're going to have it, you know, on this day, I forget what it was. I think it was we were talking about like April.
Tattooed it on my arm.
Yeah, no, yeah.
So I never forget it. I should add, because the viewers probably won't notice that we crowdfunded the book, and now we're promoting it, one that's been published by Dark Horse Comics. So we initially self-published, and then over the span of a couple years, I guess it was.
Yeah.
We've now got a fully. Brand new edition with the new cover from Dark Horse. So
congratulations. Awesome. Now.
Yeah. Yeah. But I, you know, just to say, you know, when we were ready, we did our side of it and then we sent it out to the printers. There was a problem with the supply chain, you know, because of the pandemic. And so, and I remember really stressing over that, you know, feeling really bad about it and being, you know, and then just luckily, you know, talking to a few people, you know, Mike included, but family members and be like, you know, I got to write this email and being like so like distraught about like not meeting this deadline. And then they were like, man, everyone's going to understand, like we're all going through this thing together, right? We all ordered from Amazon and it comes a week later or whatever, right? Whatever the case is. And so it was really good just to have people in my ear, having, you know, that support. But then also when I shared that, like, hey, this is going to take a lot, you know, a little bit longer than we anticipated, people were like, no problem. We're so proud of you all. And so that was reaffirming, and also just giving yourself that grace, you know, because a lot of times, sometimes we put the stress on ourselves that doesn't really exist. Like, it's not the world putting the stress on us. It's ourselves putting that stress on it. And so giving yourself that ability to just breathe through whatever challenges, whatever delay, like, it's going to arrive on its own time. And sometimes, you know, it's even better, right? Because for whatever reason, people are anticipating it even more and excited to receive it. So, so it all worked out. And like Mike said, you know, now we got Dark Horse, which was, you know, for me growing up reading Dark Horse comics, and Mike, and, you know, anybody else who's in the comic book space, to be on that publishing is, to me, is a dream come true. It's like, it's a dream I didn't even know I had until it became a reality, which is awesome.
So awesome. Yeah. Well, and I think too, you know, listening to you guys, I don't know you guys well enough to know everything about you, but you seem like your skill sets and your personalities kind of, you know, balance each other out. So Mike kind of, you know, mentioned in the beginning how you gave him the space, you know, to kind of work. And I think that's great when you're doing, you know, collaborations with people. It's great to work with people that are a little bit different, you, that bring different skill sets, because I think it just adds value. And in this case, you guys got a great, you know, book company behind you, and we're able to pull this thing together. And you know, something you said, Tim, you know, about, I think when we're goal driven, we get very set on how we want things to go. And especially when we have other people, you know, on board in the space, we don't want to let people down. And, you know, when you were saying that, I could feel it. Cause I'm like, I know I've been there before where I'm like, oh my gosh, I promised somebody I'm going to do something and I can't make it happen. And I'm beating myself up about it. And most of the time people understand, right? Like, they're cool with it. They get it. We're all humans. We're going through things. We're working the best we can. And sometimes Amazon does suck. Like, the Prime doesn't always show up on the day it's supposed to show up, right? Yeah. It is what it is. So, but you guys, you made it happen, you know, and that's what matters.
Yeah. I think it also speaks to how you have to be flexible in general in your thinking and in your strategy, you know, because you just, you know, I remember my wife when she was in grad school, and she would tell me there was this saying for when people were doing their papers, and like, you just have to surrender them. Like, because they'd be like, I'm not done. I need to keep doing it. She's like, and the teacher would be like, you have to surrender
the paper,
because at some point, so you have to have that flexibility to say, okay, I need, other things in my life have to be attended to. And I'm putting like all this unnecessary pressure, you know, and I think that's something I've learned is, you know, as an artist who like freelances and works full time and has kids, you have to be able to have that flexibility so that you can adjust and pivot when it's necessary.
Yeah, it's good. So good. Yes. And you do. You're right. It's no point being rigid. Nothing's going to work. Yeah. I don't know. I feel like I've been an entrepreneur for like 20, long time. Since 1997, since my oldest, she's now 27. So we'll say 27 plus years, because I started when she was a baby. And I'm telling you, like, I have so many stories. Michael, I was laughing at you about the kids. I've had so many stories of, like, you know, kids knocking on doors, getting stuck in doggy doors, and like, things happening. And yes, you just learn patience and you learn to just go with it. You know what I mean? But I think a great thing about this is when you show people that do successful things and they're able to weather through all these different things and navigate, it just shows great skill. And it shows other people that, hey, you could be some everyday ordinary person and do these things in your home right now. You decide tomorrow you want to start writing a book, get the pen and paper out, start doing it, whatever you need to do. You know, when I did mine, I like had the ideas, but I didn't need to do illustrations for mine because it was more of a self-help type thing. But I had to get somebody to help me get that into words, because I had the ideas and the things I wanted to say, but I'm a doer and I'm not a big wordy person. Thank God for AI now. I love that thing. Cause man, you could just help me out with this, you know, but then we didn't have that. And so I had to get somebody to help me kind of put those thoughts. And, you know, and I tell people, like, the hardest thing for me putting that book together was like getting the freaking outline together. Like, I had all the thoughts and the ideas, but it was just getting it in an orderly fashion to convey the message, right? So I think it's great that you guys came together and were able to bring these different pieces together. You got the illustrator, got the person who's got the storyline, pull it together. And you guys have said so many great messages here. Would love to know what was the most fun in this? Like, what was the best part, or even, and maybe now, what's the best part of it now?
Yeah. I mean, there's been a lot of great, I'll say for me, just having these ideas, cause I draw too, not as good as Mike. And so I had these little, you know, kind of sketches that I did that I showed Mike, you know, and then he, you know, bumped him up, you know, upgraded him. But was when I would, you know, I sent him this stuff, and then he would either text or email me some of these images, you know, you know, and just to see, it was like he was in my mind, kind of like drawing out these things. And so
in our day, that's what AI was.
Yeah.
He'd put it in the prompt and I would send it back.
Exactly.
So when people listen to this, in a year from now, which is when everything will change,
they'll
be like, oh, that's what it was like AI.
This is my AI guy here, Mike.
The AI guy. Love it.
It was so. The best way is surreal. It was surreal to see these images, you know, come to life, you know, and then eventually, like the book, right? To actually have a book and to, you know, smell it. You know, I was a book geek. As much as I'm a hip hop guy, like I still love the smell of that print, you know, on there. Whether it's, you know, old book or new book. New book smell is good though. But
yeah,
right. And so to have something go from just an idea to an actual 3D, you know, physical form is exciting to me. I get a kick out of it because it shows that, you know, each and every one of us have this power to manifest these ideas and to be part of something that's productive, or someone who's productive in society, feels good. I think everyone has that ability. And that's the thing that I think is another message. Like, you know, there's nothing special about me besides taking the time to find out what makes me special, right? Like we all have our own special uniqueness. And so for me, it's like, hey, I can tell stories. I got the gift to gab. I don't have the fear to go up on stage. I can tell a story that's, you know, fantastic and imaginary and, you know, and creative. And so let me lean into that and do my part in society. Yeah. So how about you, Mike? What was,
Two things. Especially with something like this, it's so immersive when you're creating it visually. So there's that sense of like being in the story.
Mm.
Yeah. And I still have just a lot of memories of scenes in the story that like I really got into. There's like a scene where they're in this tower and there's all of these wild boars running up the stairs to attack them, mm-hmm. which was like when I read it, I was like, that's going to be the most complicated thing to draw, like a spiral staircase that we can see in two dimensions with wild boars running up and being mm-hmm. shot, you know. But when I was drawing that, I just remember like I was so into the intensity of that scene. Yeah. And so, you know, being in that story for a while is it's exciting. It makes you like want to get up and work on it, you know, during that time. But the other thing that I think really sticks out to me is when we go to like a show, like a comic convention, and we see people react to the book or somebody comes up and said, I read it, I really liked it. Or, you know, because there's that feeling of like, I always sort of talk about this, where artists, we have this tendency to like work in a vacuum if we're not like performers. So this, you're sort of working in solitary confinement. Yeah. And then you're not really, you know, it's just so enriching when people interact with you through your art, because you're like, oh, they're actually kind of like connect. I loved doing this, but now they love experiencing it. So there's this really great synergy that happens when you're able to, you know, connect on that level. And I see that the most when we go to sort of these comic conventions. We have a table, people come, hey, what's the book about? You guys wrote this, you drew this, you know, how long did, you know, and they're like, they have reactions to it. And for me, that just feels really good to just be like validated.
Because we've done like school assemblies and stuff, and to have these young people come up and relate and have, you know, organizations who buy the books and then have the kids like read it and then, you know, bring us in to talk about it and to have, you know, young people say like, hey, this, I know these characters are me, like they could see themselves.
They can relate. As these
characters. Yeah. It is great. And then online, you know, like even today, you know, it was cool to just have, you know, someone post and like, oh, tracking, they showed the tracker. They're like, I can't wait for this to come in, because it was a gift for their son. They can't wait for them to get it. And they, you know, posted that and they tagged us on it. And I'm like, yes, let's go. You know, that's really exciting to see people interacting, like Mike said, with something that was just this idea or something that was in a vacuum. And now it's, you know, it's like watching your kid, right, grow up and they, you know, they hit
it
the
is. It's more,
they,
it's, I mean, it's another child, basically, right? You something you created and you put it out into the world and you hope people, you know, latch it and take care of it and bring it to life for you. So Mike, I really like what you were talking about, like because I'm listening to you and I'm kind of a I'm a visual. I feel things. So I listen to people talk and I'm like, I can see this. Like, I've had artists on here before. I had this really amazing painter on here one time. Amazing. She did murals and stuff. And she would talk about how she would go in her room and play her, you know, play her music when she's working. And she'd just go in there for hours. And I could just visualize this, like being in there for hours and just like painting and like create. So I could see this, like when you're in that zone and you're just like looking in this and you're trying to create that, take this thing and make it life-like, right? Like, put it into art. I'm not an artist like that. I mean, I like to play with paints and do things, but not like that. But I can totally hear what you're saying, you know, and to listen to you, Tim, say, okay, this was my, what I was seeing in my picture, and then to give it him, and then he brings it alive. And I'm like, yes, this is what I'm talking about. My AI guy, you know, whatever that is. But anyways, I love it. I think it's good. Thank you for answering. I do want to ask you guys one really fun question. I love to ask this one every once in a while, because I think it's just fun from your perspective. Like, what does this look like for you? But I would love to know from both of you, how you look at success. Like, how do you define success for yourself? Mm-hmm. And it can be about this book too. I don't, you can bring that into it, this project.
Well, Jen, this is actually something I've really thought about deeply. And, you know, when I went to grad school for printmaking a while ago, before I kind of, before this life, in my past life. But I remember that I had a dream that I wanted to become like a professor. And that was sort of the track that I was on. And I had, there were a lot of professors I worked with who I really admired, who were doing what I was like, this is what I want to do. I want to be a tenure track professor. I want to exhibit in galleries. And what I found was that even though a lot of the professors I looked up to were very successful, they were sort of miserable. like, you know, there was a lot, like I just saw into their personal lives. And it was just sort of like, wow, it's like, success for me is that I'm happy, right? Mm-hmm. Not the other way around. And and I think that what success looks like changes as time goes on too, you know, because some people might think that being famous is this means success to them. But then when they realize that that's not what it was, and you know, those kinds, you always hear about these kinds of things. So for me, I think if I'm meeting my core needs where it's like, I'm able to support myself, and I'm happy, then I feel that I've been successful in what I'm doing. You know, if I set out a goal that is realistic, and I achieve that goal, then that's also a sign of success too. So I think, you know, there's sort of like different sort of abstract ways to look at it for me when I think.
It's good. Yeah. I like it. It's good.
No, that's awesome. And Mike, I'll just expand and go a different way, because I agree. It's all about happiness. You know, at the end of the day, you got to be happy. You got to feel that what you do is meaningful. You know, I always say, you know, I came up in the era in hip hop where, you know, keeping it real was so important, like being authentically you. Not selling out, right, was really important, meaning that, you know, you're not putting, you know, profits over people or, you know, profits over planet. It's just for me, values that have been passed down from my parents and from people who I admire. And so it's really about being part of this lineage of this culture of like comics, like, hey, this is a comic book story. This is a story that's meant to inspire, to have people be like, yeah, I'm that guy that can tap into the superpowers. And I want, you know, it was great because I went down to Nashville, Tennessee. I was mentoring some young people down there. And this little girl who, you know, comes to find out she was, you know what the right term is. So excuse me if I say the wrong term, but she was on the spectrum. And the teacher, you know, I gifted a book to the class, and this little girl grabbed this book and just immediately opened it up and started like it was almost like she was eating it, inhaling it, devouring it, you know, and she was just looking at everything. And the teacher, even because we were like doing something else, she was like, okay, you can read that later. And she like, no, and I kind of felt bad. I'm like, no, let her read it now. She like was the way that she was enjoying it. For me, honestly, like that, my work was done with that book at that moment. Like I achieved the ultimate level of success. And I know for some people, like, yeah, right, you want to know, like, and I tell my kids, like, we didn't write this book, you know, because I have adult kids. We didn't write this book to become millionaires, billionaires. Like, that's nice. Like, we all want, you know, the more you have, the more you could give is what I want to, you know, why I want to attract abundance to me. But it's really for that moment, for that little girl to really connect to this art form, and to see herself was so profound. So that was success in that exact moment.
That's good. I liked both of them because I could resonate with both of what you said. So it was good. I liked both of them. I'm Michael. I'm totally with you in that you got to be happy. And if you're not, I always say, you know, if you're, I use Maslow's hierarchy needs, right? Like you get all those things met in there and you're doing what you love to do. I mean, you're going to be doing okay. And you're impacting people, which is what Tim is saying, is making a difference in the world and the, with the people around you. So I think that really that's what it comes down to. I like the way y'all worded it very differently, but I think they're very similar and, you know, kind of finished them out. So very good. Okay. So I want to ask you guys a couple fun questions.
Oh, nice.
I like to do this. They're just random off the cuff. I'll probably ask one, ask the other, you know, okay. Michael, ask you a different one, but I want to know, okay, Tim, where is the coolest place you've been able to travel with your work?
Oh, the coolest place. Oh man. I'll say Portugal. That came to mind. You know, New Year's Eve in Lisbon, with a hip hop group that also had like Cape Verdean Creole music in it. And so that was pretty fun.
Yeah. All right. Awesome. Michael, what is like the absolute best thing you love to draw? Is it this like comic stuff or is there other things that you really enjoy as far as art goes?
I mean, I really enjoy doing, I love line work. So something that's really graphic like that, but I love really sort of creepy, horrific, like monster type stuff. Yeah.
So like, see, I always learn cool things about people. That's why I love
That's like, so in the book too, there were scenes, there's characters where like Tema had to sort of reel me in a little bit.
Come on back, Mike. Like, we don't want to scare the young adults.
Well, I like horror flicks, so you might be speaking my language. Everybody's like, how do you like that stuff? I'm like, it's like riding a roller coaster. It's just, you get adrenaline rush. It's not, you know, it's not real. I mean, whatever.
But it depends where I'm at, you know, mentally.
Yep.
I like to do like children's books too. So
yeah. All right, Tim, I would love to know, like, because you obviously are, you know, you're a rap artist, hip hop rap artist. Is there any other music that you like besides that? Anything else that you listen to that's kind of a regular?
All kinds. I do listen to Enya, Mike. classical music. I love classical music. Reggae is a big genre for me. And believe it or not, heavy metal. I'm a big fan of Iron Maiden, Slayer, you know, who else? There's a Guns N' Roses, a bunch of heavy metal stuff. Yeah, Twisted Sister. No,
I feel like what
I'm starting to think we're not good.
I love music as a whole. You know, Cesaria ever. So going back to Cape Verde, you know.
Yeah.
You know, rest in peace to Sarah Tavares, who just passed away, which is a great Cape Verdean artist too. So across the board, I love
all over.
If it's good, I'm
you like it.
I like it.
It's funny you say that because today, you know, I don't know if y'all do Spotify. I do Spotify and they do like those year-end reviews. And so today I'm looking at my thing and I'm like, my music is all over. But today I was actually on hip hop, 90s hip hop music today.
Oh,
and I was downloading like all these to add to my list. It's like my music
serious,
will go from that. It could be Guns N' Roses. It could be Nine Inch Nails. And then the next day it could be Clint Black. I don't know. It's all over the place.
I'm curious. What 90s hip hop were you into?
What was coming up on there? I had a... Well, you know, MC Hammer was popping up on there. Yeah. Too legit to quit.
Legit,
there was a bunch on there. Shaggy was coming up on there and Snoop Dogg and I was looking up at Sir Mix-a-Lot. Like I had a birthday party recently and people follow me now. I turned 51 this year. So I went to this dual piano thing.
Yeah.
And they had us all come up on stage. And apparently somebody must have known that we were kind of in that clubbing age or whatever, because they wanted us to dance to Baby's Got Back and Jump, and Jump, Jump, and Tootsie Roll.
So we
all got up there and I was like, none of us were doing any of that. Like, I was like, I think we were just supposed to twerk on that thing, but none of us were doing any of it. Thankfully, people got video. I like clipped all the video. I'm like, nobody's even going to see that one happening. So anyways.
Yeah, my wife that thing up is her favorite thing.
Oh, from Juvenile.
Juvenile, but whatever, that's like the classic twerking video.
Exactly. Like the old music, right? Oh, and Run DMC. I had a couple of those on there too. I was pulling a couple of those. I like Run DMC.
Classic.
With you. All right. One last question for you, Michael, and then we'll wrap this thing up. So when you're working, I want to know, because this is like a working question. When you're actually drawing, do you put any music on or are you totally like in your zone quiet?
It's a combination. I got into the habit of listening to speeches for a while.
Ooh.
So I would listen to, I actually listened to Cornel West. And
yeah.
I was listening to some philosophers. What's his name? Sadhguru is like a mystic guy.
Yeah.
So I do a combination of that, and then I'll listen to music. Like I'll throw on some reggae, or I like old soul music. Yeah. Stuff like that.
I could totally see you listening to stuff. I think you're kind of a thinker. I could totally see it happening.
Otis Redding.
Yeah, Otis Redding's on there. Mm-hmm. Great live performances of him on Spotify.
Very cool. Yeah. We all have our thing. Like, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like when I run, I have friends that go running. They don't listen to any music at all. Like I have to have, and the faster the music, the better the workout. Like if I have slow music, my run's going to be like, you know, so. Yeah. Anyways, you guys have been fun. I've had an awesome time chatting with you. I'd love to know. So if our audience wants to get in touch with you, maybe they want to pick this book up, get a copy of it, check it out. Where do we want to send them?
Yeah. Well, first of all, it's available everywhere. You can even order it on Target and Walmart, you know, Amazon, but also at the website. So planetablue.com. So it's like planet with an A. So Planeta and then blue without the E. .com. So Planeta.
I like the name of it, by the way. It sounds
fun.
Thank
you. Thank you. Yeah.
I've been seeing your emails and stuff. So congratulations to you both. You're awesome. It's fun to see people, you know, doing amazing things in the world and trying to make, you know, everything better for all of us. I love it.
Yes.
Sharing the story.
Awesome. Thanks for having us.
Absolutely. We do want to say to our audience, of course, if you enjoy the show, please head over to Apple, give us a review there. You can check us out on YouTube, hit that subscribe button. And as I always say, I say the same thing every week. In order to live the extraordinary, you must start. Every start begins with a decision. You guys take care, be safe, be kind to one another. We will see you next time.